currently a professor at North Carolina State University, and she did a postdoc at UC Santa Cruz, and I very briefly overlapped with her when she was a graduate student at Carnegie University. I would tell you about her work, but she's going to, so I'll let her do that.
All right, thanks, Neil. Is the mic working out okay for everybody?
Yep.
All right, perfect. Great, so, yeah, so this talk is titled Anti-Disciplinary, Doing a PhD When You Like Too Many Things. And this is mostly a talk about how I kind of got through my PhD, because I don't like to give advice, because I think advice is not generic, right? All of our life experiences are different. But I would like to tell you a little bit about my experience, and maybe there's something you can take away from that. So as Neil mentioned, I'm currently an assistant professor in my second year of doing that. That's equivalent to a lecturer in UK terminology. And I did a postdoc at the University of California, Santa Cruz with a group called the Expressive Intelligence Studio, which is all about using artificial intelligence in ways that enable and support creativity and creative applications such as games and interactive storytelling. I did my PhD at CMU in the Principles of Programming group, which is all about applying mathematics and logic to the study of programming. So that's the kind of official CV version of who I am. What I want to tell all of you about me is that I went into grad school thinking that I was completely pure theory. I wanted to, my first project was doing a proof in a dependently typed language about dependently typed languages, and I didn't really think about applications very much at all. I also assumed I probably wouldn't finish, actually. There were many moments of self-doubt in my PhD studies, and I had a lot of difficulty identifying a topic that I really wanted to pursue. But what I ultimately wound up doing was I found myself in my free time kind of trying to apply some of the ideas that I had learned quite deeply in grad school to my hobbies. So I was interested in interactive storytelling and interactive fiction, particularly kind of in the tradition of the 80s text adventure games. Have any of you heard of those or played them at all? Have any of you played any of the kind of modern story-based games, like from Telltale Games, for instance? Okay, cool. So I was just interested in these things for fun, and I started trying to apply logic to it. And then suddenly I turned it into a thesis, graduated, and got a tenure track job. Easy as that. Any questions? Okay, so before I go on, I actually want to learn a little bit about who's in the audience. So could you raise your hand if you're currently in a PhD program? And could you put your hands down and raise your hand if you're currently in a master's program? And hands down, and then hands up again if you're in a bachelor's program. Okay, cool. There's a great mix of people here. That's really great to hear. Is anybody here from industry? Okay, cool. Three of you. For how many of you is this your first academic conference? Anybody? Yes, many of you. Okay, very good. Cool. How many of you are giving a talk here by any chance? Well, a lot of the people who are giving a talk at UNW and yeah, elsewhere. Are any of you giving a talk for the first time at ICFP? Okay, wonderful. That's really awesome to hear. So what I want to tell to all of you for that you raised your hand during that part is that you're going to have a great time. You're going to hear a lot of advice, I think, in PLNW about how to make the most of being at a conference, or at least I hope you will. But my advice, I think I'll just summarize, is you're in this beautiful city of Oxford, you're around fellow nerds who have a lot of interests in common with you. Don't worry too much about going out and trying to impress people or, trying to make your name known or anything like that. Just really try to relax and enjoy it, and these kinds of connections that you'll form with people with similar interests will carry you forward and you'll get something out of those in the long run. Also, take downtime if you need it. How many of you are kind of introverted or shy or find being around people a little bit tiring? Okay, so me too. It's okay if you find conferences exhausting. You can take time off. You don't have to constantly be on. You don't have to constantly be trying to talk to people. That's also something that nobody told me when I first went to my first conference, so I want you all to know that. Okay. One more question for you. Well, a couple more, I guess. How many of you have ever felt like, I guess this mostly is about, for those of you in a PhD program, that you can't decide on a thesis topic, or that you might have trouble deciding on a thesis topic because you're interested in too many things? Awesome. Okay, that's really most of you. Great. Or raise your hand again if maybe you're not quite sure of whatever department you're in, whether that's maybe computer science, mathematics, informatics. Doesn't quite completely define the set of interests that you have. Maybe this is a smaller group, but yeah, okay, so still quite a few of you. So my research combines a lot of different fields. I have told people at various points in various different contexts that my research focus is computational narrative, procedural generation, programming language design, formal methods, usually using algebra and logic, and game design. And I named my lab POEM, the principle, which stands for Principles of Expressive Machines, to sort of mash up the titles of the two labs I spent time in, Principles of Programming and Expressive Intelligence. And what this lab is about is the kind of interdisciplinary research that I like to do, or what people would describe perhaps as interdisciplinary. In grad school, the thesis that I wound up doing was about linear logic and storytelling, and I created a linear logic programming language, so logic programming language based on a type of logic called linear logic that I showed could be used for modeling interactive stories. And my first PhD student's project, now as a faculty member, uses epistemic modal logic, which is a logic for reasoning about the beliefs of different characters, for codifying agent beliefs and meta beliefs to inform goal-directed actions. This is sort of an artificial intelligence project. We're applying it to games and storytelling, and it's based in formal logic. I've had a number of undergraduate researchers work with me while I started at NC State, and some things that they've done is use my programming language called Scepter to create an executable model of group conversation that works based on sociolinguistic theory. So this is kind of a simulation of sociolinguistics in a linear logic programming language. I had another student model the mechanics of the game Minecraft in order to show that we could basically re-derive and potentially generate quests or sets of achievements that players can pursue through the mechanical structure. And some active projects in my lab, in case any of you might be looking for a place to do your PhD and considering applying to NC State, which I encourage. So some of the projects that I'm looking for people to work on now include basically a framework for authoring interactive fiction that aims to democratize some of these sophisticated AI techniques and put them into a more authorable, accessible system so that writers or people without a lot of programming experience can create virtual worlds with autonomous agents. And another one is applying linear logic programming. This is sort of outside of the games and storytelling domains. I'm also collaborating with a mathematical modeler of biological systems to see if we can apply linear logic programming to doing that. So the fields that are currently or aspirationally informing my research practice include visual narrative theory, cognitive science, systems biology, linguistics, sociology, history, theater, and even some category theory sometimes. And it's too many things. I'm kind of like, let's apply all the things, all the methodologies to the research that I want to do. And this is because I really find most of these fields just inherently interesting, and I keep rediscovering some of the same concepts that initially drew me into programming languages and formal methods in all of these other fields. So it's really hard to fit into disciplinary boundaries. I could call it computational creativity. There's actually an IECCC International Conference on Computational Creativity. And there's, of course, CHI, the Conference on Human-Computer Interaction, which encompasses many of these applications that I'm looking at. However, they usually take wildly different approaches to creating them and don't necessarily care that the computational concepts underlying these things are foundational or formally verifiable in any way. They're more interested in having a human subject's evaluation of the end artifact that you produce. In programming languages and formal methods, this is really my home field and I love it. But in some sense, the reason that I became gravitated, that I sort of gravitated towards these other fields was because I wasn't as interested in talking just about the minutiae of programs. I wanted to talk about what sorts of new expressive media we could enable with those things. And finally, people started calling me an AI researcher around the time that I was doing my postdoc, and I found this really confusing because most people, when they hear AI these days, will think of machine learning techniques, since that's what people have decided is the AI that actually works and not that, you know, classical AI that where we try to do everything too neat and not scruffy enough, and so it didn't work. But it turns out that people are still kind of doing that kind of AI in these very synthetic realms of virtual environments and interactive stories, and so a lot of people saw what I was doing as having connections to that. So, you know, I don't mind this term in some ways, but it also has ambiguous connotations. So I really like this term anti-disciplinary, which I stole from another Carnegie Mellon faculty member, Golan Levin, who runs something called the Studio for Creative Inquiry at CMU. And I really love his work. It's very different from mine, but it's also extraordinarily broad in the kinds of disciplines it encompasses. His whole thing is making art with technology and with code. So this is a picture from one of his projects, which is an interactive art installation using projected light, where you can stomp on the floor and the projected light bulb will bounce around. So his website and projects are good for getting pretty pictures to put on slides. And so he uses this term, and I think he stole it from the MIT Media Lab, which is another group that does really wildly, multidiscipline, broad-reaching research, combining artistic methodologies with computational and scientific methodologies. So the reason this is not interdisciplinary is because interdisciplinary usually suggests you're kind of doing something that's like a subset of one field over here and a subset of one field over here and combining them. But really, a lot of this work is kind of falling outside of these of the discipline boundaries entirely, and overlapping or possibly even containing entire other established disciplines. What I find about who winds up here, though, is pretty cool. So, often people who already feel like outsiders in traditional STEM communities or traditional computer science communities, such as women, underrepresented minorities, LGBTQ folks, come to interdisciplinary fields. And I was talking to my collaborator, Uda Aka, about why this is, and her theory is that we're already comfortable with feeling outside the norm and with feeling like we have a difficult time explaining who we are and why we're here. And so interdisciplinary work kind of speaks to us because it's not a big leap to suddenly start doing work that's outside of the field that we started in. And it's a space that we're already kind of comfortable with. So these are some pictures of some of the folks whose work I've gotten to know and in some cases collaborated with, and I feel very fortunate for doing so. So just to name them from going around, let's say, starting up there and going clockwise, Rogelio Cardona Rivera, Kate Compton, Mitu Kandikar Kondomis, Arnav Jala, Jillian Smith, and Belinda Apa. And I should have put their names up here so you could look up their work, because they all do really incredible anti-disciplinary work. So what do I get from all this? So by the way, I'm going to end very short. You don't have to sit here and listen to me ramble on for an entire hour. So I really want to try to facilitate some discussion. So please be writing down questions if you have them, so that we can talk to each other after this talk is over. I wanted to say that at the beginning. For me, the takeaway point, if I had to give, so this is, I'm starting to use imperative statements, which means I'm giving you advice, right, which I said I wouldn't do. But for me, like, the one thing that I think has been consistently invaluable for me is, well, sort of a meta value, right, identifying my values and remaining true to them. So for me, some of my values in research are basic research, which is to say studying fundamental ideas rather than trying to identify hot topics that have immediate applications in the world, right? I know there are lots of people who do amazing applied research, And I still don't think of myself as an applied researcher, even though a lot of what I'm doing is taking ideas from formal logic and trying to turn them into usable tools. But I still think of what I'm trying to do as contributing to our basic understanding of the fields of computer science and the fields of the humanities and social sciences and so on. And that's been an important anchor for me as I start interacting with these other fields. And finally, one of my other values is that fields outside of computer science and outside of STEM more broadly have valid and valuable research methodologies. This is a standpoint that I've actually found curiously absent in a lot of computer science research. I talk to other computer scientists and I'll tell them that at a conference somebody was presenting a game that they had created, and sometimes the response is like, well, that's not research. And what they mean is, it's not science, right? You're not doing a rigorous study to collect collect data and analyze it, or you're not doing a proof about formal proof about a system. But you're actually participating in a form of research, or as some of our friends in the humanities and arts call it, a form of inquiry that is based on a methodology that's very old and has a long tradition. And it's not any less rigorous, really. It's just a different approach. And I think that all of those things are valid, and we should consider combining them more often. We should consider what approaches to validating the things we really want to do are appropriate, because sometimes a scientific approach doesn't validate the things that we're actually interested in. So what's worked out for me so far is that I got a tenure track job, which I honestly wasn't expecting, because I'm applying one field that nobody cares about to another field that I thought nobody cared about. And then it turned out that the US job market was actually really interested in games research at the time that I applied. And my background in programming languages was seen as sort of a unique plus, because I had some rigorous formal background and I was approaching things in a different enough way from how everybody else was approaching it, that this seemed valuable. So in my case, actually being at this intersection worked out, I think, remarkably well. And that's not going to be the case for everybody. The academic job market is, of course, in many ways, just very random, and involves a lot of chance connections and so on. So the next thing that I wanted to talk about is kind of about improving your odds with chance connections, which is getting to know people. And as I said in the beginning of the talk, I find interacting with people somewhat exhausting personally, and it's taken me a long time to be comfortable even standing at the front of a room and talking to all of you in this way. But at one point, I was talking to someone that I've seen as a mentor in the human-computer interaction department at Carnegie Mellon, Jess Hammer, who was hired a couple of years before I graduated. And in one meeting with her, she said to me at the end of this meeting, "You'll be fine because you're a people person." And I was shocked by this statement, because I said, "I'm a what?" I think that over time, to my disbelief, I had actually become comfortable and happy with talking to people and sharing ideas and sharing passion for the research and the values that I care about. And that's been really important, because it's led me to find kind and inspiring collaborators who've also helped me out a lot in the course of my career. So being a people person is not an inherent property, it's a skill, and you can change it. So if you don't feel like you're good at making those connections, and you think networking sounds terrifying and you hate that you have to do it, I was there too once, and you can improve and you can get better at that skill. And it's worth doing. It will really help you a lot. And finally, another thing that's been working well for me is that there's a lot of interest in what I'm doing. Students have been, especially undergrad students, but really a lot of students have been very interested in how you can make a research career out of creative endeavors like games and storytelling. And so I'm finding a lot of people really would like to get involved with that kind of research. That there's a lot of public interest. I use social media a lot, and I'm on Twitter. I'll put my handle up at the end of the talk. to kind of try to get my ideas out there a little bit faster than having to write the paper and wait for the reviews and then publish the paper and then put it on my website. And that's, you know, and people are responding to it well. And, you know, another thing about doing research in a very niche area is that if anything else comes up, which a surprising amount of it does, at the intersection of these two fields, a lot of people know that I'm in that space and will come to me and say, hey, I found this interesting thing people were working on. The most recent example I can remember of this is Clifford Wolf is, I think, just a hobbyist, but he was doing a formal verification of a text adventure game to show that it was impossible to get stuck in the game. And he published this formal proof of it. And then I had, like, I think 10 people telling me, hey, have you seen this work? And I was so excited that I was someone that people thought of when they saw that. On the other hand, there's a lot that's still really hard that I still haven't figured out. And if any of you have ideas or would be able to help me figure this out, I would love to hear your advice to me. So one question is, you know, what grants do I apply for? So when you're in a field that's hard to put into a particular bid, you know, do you apply for, so even if within the computer science, so the National Science Foundation is the American funding agency that funds a lot of computer science research, and they have sort of these four directorates where you have to basically put yourself in one of those bins or another, and it's completely unclear to me which of them to do, so I wind up being told in response when I complain about this to other faculty members, oh, just try for both, right? In some cases, you can mark more than one, but then you're actually being evaluated simultaneously by each of those different fields, so you have to be able to, in some sense, you have to do twice as much work because you have to explain yourself in terms that each of those disciplines can understand. And because I go to conferences that are both in, you know, programming languages, formal methods, and in games and computational creativity, I kind of have to, you know, do that much more traveling. I have to do that much more writing papers and so on in order to stay involved and active with those conferences and communities. Question two, is it even possible to fund? So I'm coming with you and telling you that this has worked, but I don't yet have funding for my research. So I'm still, like I said, you know, trying to apply to all these grants and see if something will work out. But I don't yet know if it does. I don't know. I know that people are interested in working on it, but I don't know if anybody's interested in paying for it yet. Where are the folks who I can collaborate with? So there are a lot of possibilities, but finding someone who kind of shares my like-minded set of values can be somewhat difficult. And finally, there's definitely a language barrier issue because anytime that you're trying to do work that applying something from here to over here, or trying to do work that actually contributes in some ways to each of two different fields, you have to be able to explain what you're doing to each of those fields, or, you know, if you're in more than two, then just that many more. So you have to know the language, you have to know the terminology, the jargon, and you have to know how to translate between several different fields. So it's a lot of work. I think it's worth it, but it's a lot. And that's pretty much all that's what I wanted to leave you with, because I don't want to tell you that there are any magic answers or that everything is solved, but I wanted to give you this perspective on where research in programming languages and formal methods might take you if you're anything like me. And at this point, I kind of wanted to leave it up to you to ask me questions and help me help you. Thanks.
Difficult to find a job where geographic